Good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting of 2022 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Today's meeting is being held virtually. I'm not anticipating any connectivity problems, but if there are, Colin Beattie as Deputy Convener will take over the chairing of the meeting. So our first item of business is a decision to take item C in private and for the committee to agree to take further discussions of our work programme in private future meetings. Is that agreed? Thank you. So our next item of business is our evidence session on broadband connectivity, and I welcome Kate Forbes, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy, who is joined by Clive Downing, the R100 Programme Director, and Robert McGee, Deputy Director for Digital Connectivity, the Scottish Government. As always, if members and witnesses could keep questions and answers as concise as possible, that would be helpful, and I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'll take the opportunity to just make some comments at the outset in what is a very important area for Scotland, because every part of the economy, every part of government is currently being transformed by digital connectivity and by the data, the technologies and the applications that it enables. And whilst I think all of us recognise the critical need for reliable digital infrastructure prior to the pandemic, the pandemic has emphasised that further still, and certainly has forced the pace of digital transformation. And that really is the reason why we are investing very substantial Scottish Government resources in what is a reserved area, delivering improvements in digital infrastructure through unprecedented times. And I'm certainly very proud of what we've achieved, but very conscious too of the need to make sure that we complete the job and we complete it well. We delivered the commitment to ensure that every home and business could access superfast broadband connections by the end of last year through a combination of the R100 contracts, the nationwide voucher scheme and commercial coverage. And all remaining connections are being delivered through the R100 contracts will be full fibre connections, delivering gigabit capable connectivity on the ground. The R100 programme currently has ships out in the North Sea, laying 16 new fibre optic subsea cables to connect 15 Scottish islands. And that's quite clearly a transformational investment. I had seen the UK government's gigabit project as the next opportunity to deliver more targeted investment, working quite well alongside the R100 programme. There's £5 billion available for investment across the UK through the UK government's Project Gigabit. But as it stands, the sort of investment that the Scottish Government is currently making in subsea cables and so on will not be possible via Project Gigabit, which is instead to focus on the cheapest non-commercial premises. Project Gigabit has an arbitrary cost cap of £7,000. In other words, if it costs more than £7,000 to connect to premises anywhere in the UK, then the UK Government won't fund it. Now, I know that committee would hopefully join me in appealing it to the UK government to express the point that to connect the hardest to reach areas in Scotland will inevitably cost more than £7,000 per property. My correspondence with the UK government minister has not been fruitful to date. And I quote the UK government minister on this point when she said, "The Scottish government are seeking to have greater spend in areas like islands and parts of rural Scotland. Greater spend in those areas than that going to other parts of England, and she cannot ask people in other parts of the country to suffer." But quite clearly, I think all of us have an interest in connecting the hardest to reach areas, and if it costs more than £7,000 per property, then we need to complete the job. But having invested well over £600 million already from the Scottish Government's budget in a reserved area, we can't simply keep picking up the tab for the UK Government on broadband. So Project Gigabit looks like it's going from a transformational opportunity to a missed opportunity for Scotland, and hopefully we can get into a little bit more detail about that when it comes to the Q&A in this session. Convener, I could go on to talk about the 4G infill programme in terms of mobile masts, working with our project partners WHP Telecoms, who have activated 28 masts, as well as the work we're doing on 5G through the Scotland 5G Centre and so on. But I'm conscious about keeping my remarks to remarks brief, and so I'll stop there and hopefully we can get into some of that in the questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I'll start with the questions and I'll take questions from other members as well. And I should note that Jamie Hardcourt-Johnson has provided his apologies for the morning's meeting. There will be questions to come on the Gigabyte project, the UK government project that you've talked about. But if maybe start with the R100 programme and progress on that. Following the delay to concluding contracts for the R100 programme, we now expect in some areas not to have connection until 2026, 27, I understand. Is the Cabinet Secretary confident that this deadline can be met? We are seeing cost increases for various reasons, including inflation. So are you also confident the budget that is in place is sufficient? You've talked about the challenges of reaching the harder to, you know, the more remote areas in Scotland and the cost, the increased costs involved in that. So is the R100 programme, are you confident that the new deadline of 26-27?
Thanks. So we are delivering at pace. So if I could just start my answer by saying that as of the 30th of April this year, 7,685 premises are able to access superfast broadband through the R100 contracts, and a further 2,200 connections have been made through the broadband voucher scheme. I am keeping the pressure up on Openreach considerably to try and roll that out at pace. And in terms of the conversations right now, where I'm always looking for us to go further is to identify any other properties or any other areas that we could reach, perhaps through a combination of Project Gigabit and R100. So in short, we are working to that deadline. We are working to that budget. Obviously, when it comes to the budget, I want to ensure that the Scottish Government is contributing, as we are, with over £600 million. But ultimately, in a reserved area, it's my duty and responsibility to make sure that we're maximising any UK government spend in this area too. So if additional funding becomes available, for example, through Project Gigabit, which is £5 billion, that could complement our work and therefore exceed the budget that has been set, but through UK government treasury, then I certainly would not say no to that. So I think that the nuance I'm incorporating here is that we've set a budget. I'm confident right now in our budget, but if I can go further with additional funding from the UK government, I absolutely will. So I hope that nuance makes sense, which is that ultimately we want to maximise the funding available, and we've set out what our contribution is. But I think if we can secure a greater contribution through Project Gigabit, we absolutely would do that.
And am I correct? I think the Audit Scotland report shows that the progress in terms of R100 is slowest in the north, which is recognised as the more difficult areas to deliver in. So, you know, so we are facing similar challenges in that it appears that the areas that are more accessible and possibly cheaper to deliver in are what's happening first before we get to the harder areas. Is that correct?
Yeah, so we signed the contract with the North lot 1 year later than the Central and the South contracts, obviously due to the legal challenges. But of the £600 million, the North contract certainly has the largest share of the investment, £384 million, which is double the total amount that was invested through the previous programme in the Highlands and Islands. So you're right in saying that it has been delayed more than the Central and the South lots, but it also includes things like 16 subsea cables, which obviously other parts of Scotland don't necessarily require. So it is a more intensive process. It's arguably one of the most important parts of R100 if R100 is built on the concept that we start from the outside in. We start with the hardest to reach premises, working backwards, rather than doing what Project Gigabit is doing, which is the cheapest, commercially easiest to reach properties.
And thank you. And can I just ask, you mentioned the subsea cables. Can I just ask for confirmation that the vessel did collect the supplies from Norway in May, and the cables are still expected to be laid by the end of this year?
I'll see if any officials want to come in on the updated timescales, but work is progressing as I understand it as expected, unless Robbie perhaps wants to update on progress on the subsea cables.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, I can confirm they are on track on track to be met by the deadline. Indeed, you can actually track the ships as they do a bit of island hopping over the course of this summer. So, really intensive bit of work over the next few months. Openreach, BT, subcontractors involved within that. But as it stands, very much on track to complete, over the summer, or the window where the weather supports such endeavours. So yeah, on track.
Okay, thank you. I'll now bring in Alexander Burnett to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. A question around the voucher scheme, and I suppose I'd like to ask you why you think it hasn't worked as well. You probably might have hoped why the uptake was so low. I know I wrote to you about the possibility of extending the deadlines for the voucher system. And I suppose questions around why some of those were turned down, and what will happen to the unspent money, and appreciating you might not have all those figures in front of you, will there be some sort of formal report or analysis of the scheme so that we can have some proper scrutiny of why it didn't work maybe as well as it could have done?
Thanks, and I know Alexander Burnett has had a significant interest in this on behalf of his constituents. So we had extended, obviously, the interim, we had extended access to the interim voucher, obviously, by 3 months, and had significantly stepped up our efforts around advertising. So we used local, national, social media, and actually in those further 3 months, there wasn't a tangible increase in the number of inquiries or applications. And again, I'll see if officials want to come in a moment. But we, you know, it is a demand-led scheme. It's ultimately a decision for property owners whether or not to go down that route. And obviously, some areas were able to combine the broadband voucher scheme with also with funding from the UK government's voucher scheme. So that was a combination of the £5,000 with funding of up to £1,500 for homes, or £3,500 for businesses. So in terms of the effectiveness, the reason that we didn't extend it further is because we hadn't seen a significant uptake in the additional 3 months of the scheme. I think the other point is that we have also tried to use sort of positive examples. We put a lot of positive examples on the website of how households had been able to use the voucher scheme, and it had also been working with about 60 broadband suppliers, local broadband suppliers, allowing them to expand their networks. But I do feel, you know, in hindsight, that we did everything we possibly could to maximise awareness and also to raise, you know, the understanding of how the voucher scheme could work. Why wasn't there a bigger uptake? I'll see if officials want to come in on that, but I certainly couldn't see value in extending it any further because of the low uptake. And just incidentally, if you want the latest figures on it, as of June 2022, the R100 voucher scheme delivered at 2,202 connections. There's a further 1,008 connections in the pipeline. And 14% of those have been fibre to the premises. I'll stop there to see if you want a follow-up question, or alternatively ask officials if they've got any ideas as to why.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, I suppose if you've got an updated figure on the unspent money in that. But I think, yeah, I certainly agree, you promoted the scheme. Yeah, we all promoted the scheme to constituents. But the fact that despite all that additional promotion, you know, despite that extension, there wasn't an uptake. What do you think was fundamentally wrong with a voucher scheme? You know, you can't, you know, people aren't going to take something up if it's not attractive enough. Is it, what was wrong with the actual scheme itself?
This is where I don't think that I have an answer as to its unattractiveness, because in terms of the correspondence I receive and the communication I've had with individuals, and also the positive examples that there have been, those that wanted to use it and apply for it and secured it were quite happy with the process, you know, working with local broadband suppliers, accessing the funding. There's no significant reason being given, either anecdotally or in our feedback from those that were unable to secure the voucher, as to particular reasons. It was a demand-led scheme. I mean, you may have other ideas, but certainly my approach to this was to try and be as flexible as possible, to say, look, we're willing to adapt it, we're willing to extend it. One point that I would perhaps make is that take up of the voucher scheme compared quite well with other demand-led interventions that are available in Scotland. So, you know, if you take Ofcom's Connected Nations report for 2021, they showed that just 288 connections across Scotland had been delivered through the UK government's universal service obligation. That's less than 1% of all universal service obligation eligible properties in Scotland. And the UK government's broadband gigabit broadband voucher scheme again just delivered 604 connections to date. So, you know, we tried to make it as flexible as possible. The terms and conditions were designed to ensure that those who chose to utilise the voucher could also afford to take a service. But actually, across the board, we're seeing a very similar picture in uptake of voucher schemes.
Okay, thank you. And just finally, sorry, the unspent money, how much is that? Where will that go now?
I will need to come back to you on that, because obviously all the full broadband funding that I've made available is still available. So that over £600 million figure that I've identified to reach 100% of properties is still that over £600 million. So there may be ways, this is to redeploy funding, but it will be spent on broadband.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I'll now bring in Colin Smith to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary, you talked about the challenges facing rural areas accessing digital opportunities, in particular connectivity, but there's also barriers when it comes to skills and indeed an understanding of the business opportunities that good digital provide, especially for small businesses, which obviously make up the vast majority in rural areas. Last week, you announced that you were scrapping proposals for a rural entrepreneur fund. And whenever we have a round of the digital boost funding, it's always very oversubscribed, and a lot of businesses don't get to access it. So, can I ask what specific support is being provided to businesses in rural areas to make sure they don't fall behind big businesses in our cities when it comes to breaking down those barriers to digital opportunities?
So I think it's a really good question. And as you will know, there's always a reluctance to talk about the opportunities of broadband when not everybody has access to broadband quite yet. But you're right in saying that if, you know, through the previous programme, let's say 95% of properties have access to broadband, certainly 95% are not necessarily making the maximum use of it. And I think that work was stepped up during the pandemic. Digital Boost has been running now for a number of years, and it is one of the most effective ways. And our commitment to spend £100 million through digital vouchers, or digital grants rather, it still stands. So we have obviously in the first 100 days of this parliament, I've provided £25 million to spend on digital connectivity. That includes things like the software, but it also includes the skills side of things, and Digital Boost has been quite effective in that. So our commitment to that still stands. You're right, in recent times it's been oversubscribed. Incidentally, prior to that, it had quite a low subscription rate. So actually trying to promote our digital products, whether it was a digital loan scheme or a Digital Boost or otherwise, was quite challenging. But I think businesses are increasingly coming round to the understanding of how digital can be transformational. So it is primarily through grant support. That grant support still stands, hasn't been changed. But at the same time, that grant support also brings in the opportunity for training and skills. There's a lot more to that answer. For example, there's a lot more in terms of the training and the reskilling piece, because ultimately what businesses also need is digitally equipped and trained and skilled employees as well. And there's various programmes that we support One of the first things I ever did was the digital startup scheme, which was taking people furthest from the job market and providing them with intensive retraining or reskilling in digital skills, and then supporting them to find work. So there are other areas that we can do that.
Is there not an argument, however, Cabinet Secretary, that we need something very specific for small businesses in our rural areas, because we know that they're not basically grasping those digital opportunities often because they don't have the skills, but also they don't have the awareness. And it's not about just bidding for digital boost funding, it's actually bringing those businesses up to a standard where they're fully aware of the opportunities that are out there. And that's a big problem for small businesses in rural areas in particular.
Yeah, well, here's an example of something that we've tried to do. You'll be familiar with CodeClan, which provides intensive retraining or reskilling for employees in digital skills. And very intentionally, we supported them opening a facility in the Highlands, specifically geared towards rural businesses. So it was different from the CodeClan that's based in Edinburgh, and it was specifically geared towards rural businesses. So there are examples of things that we have done. You need it both ways, though. There also needs to be an appetite to embrace that. And I think whether it's the middle of Edinburgh or in Skye, the same challenges will exist around skills in a very competitive environment. If you think that there's perhaps some ways that we could adapt the digital boost scheme or digital grants that make them particularly relevant to rural areas, then it's perhaps something that I'd certainly be open to suggestions or ideas of what that might look like that was specific to rural areas. But I do think it's a challenge right across Scotland.
I'll take you up on that offer, Cabinet Secretary. The convener will prevent me from doing it just now, but I'll certainly follow that opportunity up. Can I turn to the issue of mobile connectivity and again challenges facing rural areas? You suggest in your opening comments that the 4G infill programme had connected 22 masts. My understanding is the intention was to deliver 45 new masts by 2022. Is the target date of 45 new mast sites and the completion date of 2022 still on target?
So 28 masts are live. So the most recent one was in Aberdeenshire. And the Scottish 4G infill programme is investing £28.75 million, and it's at up to 55 mobile not spot areas. So we do publish regular programme updates. We're still committed to being on track to connect as many mobile masts as possible. It's not always been plain sailing. So the two challenges, I think, when it comes to mobile phone masts is that, firstly, because mobile connectivity is a reserved area, you've got to work quite collaboratively with the commercial providers. We don't have the powers of regulation to perhaps enforce or compel that we can build the mast, but we still have to work closely with the commercial providers to ensure that those masts are then used. And then the second challenge is, of course, the fact that it being a reserved area through the last few years, it's been quite difficult. But I think it's one of the most successful programmes that we have. We have those 28 masts now live, and the money is still there for us to connect up to 55 mobile not spots, which we will do as quickly as possible.
But I wasn't clear, Cabinet Secretary, that the government had quite a specific target of 45 new masts by 2022. I wasn't clear just whether that was still a target or what the actual new target date was for all of the 55 masts that are planned.
We could share. We have a pipeline of all the further build activity and the site activations from now until the programme concludes. The programme concludes in March 2023. So I'd be happy to provide more information to the committee in terms of what the plans look like between now and March 2023. We're still working. I'm not as familiar with your figure of 45. We're working to try and connect up to 55 by March.
And just a final point, Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned obviously we need providers to actually use those masks. Are we seeing mobile companies stepping up to the market and using those masks that are being created, or is that simply a case of we've got one provider? Because again, that's a challenge for people in rural areas if they're not using that provider. So is there an uptake from commercial providers where we've got several actually sharing that mask rather than simply one provider?
Yes is the short answer. So I think over the last 3 years in particular, we've seen a massive effort from mobile commercial providers work with us on the infill programme. And, you know, I think it is to their credit that even though we don't necessarily have the powers of compulsion or regulation, they have chosen to work with us collaboratively to make these masks a success. And, you know, obviously, when it comes to mobile operators, many of them are looking at how they can help, how they can deliver their coverage obligations through the infill mask programme.
Robert McGee.
Yeah, convener. It was just to add a little bit more detail on the 4G infill point. So just to confirm, as the Cabinet Secretary said, we've got 28 sites that are activated that are currently live, and we've got another 20 towers that have been built. Towers are kind of in the main served by fibre, so there's some work to get those connections and get operators kit installed and then services go live. But there will be a kind of steady stream of those throughout this year, and over and above that, we've another 5 towers that are currently in build. So it was really just to demonstrate that we're already well in excess of that original 45 target. We've already kind of outstripped that and really managed to create real momentum, and that's after a period where the programme essentially had to shut down deployment in those early months after the pandemic hit. So I think we're really, really pleased with the momentum that's been generated, and just to confirm we're already in excess of that original 45 target.
Okay, thank you. I'll now bring in Colin Beattie to be followed by Fiona Hislop.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, just a couple of questions really on connectivity. Can you provide an update on the test 5G networks that were established in Orkney and at Loch Lomond?
Yeah, I can. So in terms of the 5G networks, we obviously have that working alongside the 5G centres. We are working in those areas, particularly on the 5G networks. And I'll see if any officials want to come in on the two specifics, because I am not as well versed in the two local examples that you mentioned. Probably more familiar with the more general points around the 5G centres that we have. So I don't know if any officials want to come in on updating on those local examples.
Happy to come in. Yeah, so on that, I mean, I guess we've obviously 5G deployment by and large is very much a commercial endeavour. What the Scotland 5G Centre has done through Wave 1 projects that they delivered in the first stage of their work has really been to sort of test the technology, deploy some private 5G networks in both rural and urban locations, and then really generate lessons on how those networks can be deployed in those situations in future. So some excellent work that's been done in Orkney, that's really kind of successive projects that have built up there. And again, sort of the other element within the sort of wave one of the Scotland 5G Centre's work was really kind of making public sector assets more accessible to telecoms companies. So we've got a really, really strong kind of academic base within the centre, both utilising the knowledge of University of Strathclyde, Glasgow, other academic partners, and putting that together with industry. As I say, what we're looking to do in the coming years is really to start to generate those lessons in terms of how networks can be deployed in different ways, utilising different models in both rural and urban environments.
Just on the back of what you're saying there, is there an expectation that the network will be maintained by a commercial operator?
Well, there are a number of different instances. I mean, I guess the work in Orkney has been looking at some of the utilising some of the kind of new freedoms on spectrum, some of the new flexibilities on spectrum that Ofcom introduced, which could see different models. It might not necessarily be a mobile network operator that would maintain it. It could be more of a kind of community-led model, or some, you know, a new mobile player that's more local in nature. So that's kind of what the pilot projects in those areas are looking to test. But as I said at the start, primarily, you know, we would envisage the 5G deployment will be led by MNOs. We've already started to see that the 4G infill programme and the shared rural network has started to see mobile network operators deploy in far more rural places than they have traditionally in the past. So I think that trend will continue, but clearly, you know, we want to support the development of models that will add value to that, potentially support more local solutions as well.
Again, listen to what you're saying. Is there an end date to these tests in Orkney and Loch Lomond? And in connection with the maintenance of the network, when will there be clarity as to the model that's being used?
Well, as I say, I think that's probably one that we can maybe follow up in writing with, because I'm not, I don't have the detail to hand on the specific end dates, and we can certainly get some more detail to the committee on that.
And also on the model likely to be used?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, as I say, the kind of lessons from the first phase, certainly the Orkney programme, have already been you know, kind of written up and obviously kind of shared and have informed the next stages. So again, we can go into quite a bit of detail on that in follow-up.
Okay, and just moving on, I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary would comment on her expectations for the commercial rollout of 5G networks across Scotland and other areas of Scotland where additional public support or subsidy will be necessary to encourage the private sector to act.
So we have obviously the 5G strategy, and we established the 5G centre to try and facilitate that investment in deployment, development, commercialisation of 5G in Scotland. So there is that funding that's already in place from the Scottish Government, with an additional £4 million, which was announced last September, to deliver that S5G Connect programme. And obviously that's a network of 5G innovation hubs. But there is public investment in that already, but the aim here is to try and accelerate the adoption of 5G and to realise the technology's potential economic contribution. Again, the difficulty is that all of the issues that we're discussing just now are reserved. So in terms of our role has got to complement the work that's already going on, either that's commercially led or that's UK government led. And that's where we deemed on the 5G centres, creating these hubs. And you may be familiar with the fact that the hubs are in Forth Valley, Dundee, Dumfries, Kilmarnock and Aberdeen, and they'll all have a different focus. But that's really where we can add value, contribute some funding, but it has to be ultimately commercially led or UK government led.
So based on what you were saying previously and what you're saying now, it would appear that there'll be regions of Scotland that will need additional public support, not necessarily from the Scottish Government, but perhaps from the UK government, in order to get the private sector into action?
Well, I don't think necessarily it's always investment that's required to get the private sector to operate in this area. Obviously, you're talking about the 5G providers in this regard, about them rolling it out. We obviously want to incentivise them to roll it out. We are doing that in a number of different ways, not least through the 5G centres. But ultimately, it will be a commercial decision taken by the providers. So we can act as an incentive. We can do things like develop use cases on private 5G test networks. We can support SMEs with the skills they need. And obviously, if a commercial provider sees appetite for adoption and commercialisation, then it is more commercially attractive to them to roll it out. So I think there's other ways of us trying to incentivise commercial providers to roll out 5G.
Okay, thank you. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you. I'll now bring in Fiona Hudslop to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Clearly, £600 million spent by the Scottish Government in effectively a reserved area is a considerable investment, and this digital collectivity has to be for a purpose. So how are you ensuring that the R100 programme, the 4G/5G support is fitting in with the Scottish Government's aims and responsibilities in devolved areas, particularly, for example, the green recovery or the wellbeing economy, or indeed city deals or work of the enterprise agencies? How are you making sure there's a synergy with your national transformation strategy for the economy to make sure we're getting best value for this additional complementary spend?
Yeah, it's a great question. And I think in terms of our objectives, both economically as well as socially, both rely on adequate broadband infrastructure, well, good broadband infrastructure. So I take those two in turn. From an economic perspective, tech is forecast to be the second fastest growing sector over the next few years. And so the economic opportunities for Scotland are enormous. And we've seen in the last few years a number of, for example, global businesses choosing to relocate or to establish their tech hubs in Scotland. So the Barclays campus, for example, as well as some of the other banks establishing tech hubs in Scotland. They're doing that because they recognise that we have the talent, the pipeline of labour, but also a growing reputation on technology. But that relies on the basics, as it were, of broadband connectivity. And then on the social side, you'll be aware of the work that was done during the pandemic on trying to on connecting Scotland. So trying to reduce digital exclusion by providing devices, internet connections, training, support for digitally excluded low-income households. And that has transformed their lives when we get it right, when we get that skills alongside the hardware required, because those that were perhaps feeling isolated or excluded or lonely during the pandemic could now reach other people. So both of those examples are probably in our DNA as a government, on both the economic aspirations for prosperity, but also on our well-being aspirations for inclusion and so on. Both of them rely on broadband connectivity. And we could wait and wait and wait for the UK government to deliver that infrastructure we need, or we get on with it ourselves. And we've chosen to get on with it ourselves.
So can I maybe ask about delivery? Aspiration is all well and good. The cities, from a commercial point of view, would have been, I think, certainly connected in terms of the levels that are required anyway. So it comes back, I think, to Colin Smith's point. How are we making sure that this additional Scottish Government spend of over £600 million is actually leveraging, particularly because we're the Economy Committee, economic growth in the areas that your plans, the Scottish Government's plans, and the delivery of those you've gone through are going to make a difference? So what difference does it make? And instead of just aspiration, how do you know it will be delivered? And what will success look like for those places that have been connected via the Scottish Government spend?
Yeah, so you're right in saying, and Colin Smith was right in saying, that the infrastructure is insufficient. The infrastructure is, it's, once you've done that, that's great. If I use an example on this, and again, going back to the digital boost funding, which used to be in the region of a couple of million pounds a year and is now up to £25 million. The other thing that we've done differently is that it now needs to leverage in private funding. So it's not just a case of receiving a grant, which you spend and then you forget about it. We now have that needs to be matched essentially by private sector investment. So already you're doubling the investment almost immediately between public and private to invest in digital connectivity. And if I go back to the economic strategy, one of the most effective ways of improving productivity that was identified is that private sector investment in capabilities. So in terms of outcome, you know that we have a commitment to improve productivity significantly in line with OECD comparator countries. If you want the metric of success, that's the big metric of success. The steps along the way are for how we ensure that every penny of public sector spend on digital is actually being doubled by the private sector. And that for me is an example of both aspiration, where we want to get to in productivity, but reality. This has already happened. This has already happened in the digital funding that's been spent on improving capabilities and improving skills. And I suppose the other example that I've already cited of talking about past tense, where this has actually worked, is if you talk to some of these banks, you talk to Barclays, why locate in Scotland? Why locate your tech hub in Scotland? Well, part of the reason is because they think it's an attractive place to establish a tech hub because of the combination. And that's set to create, you know, considerable numbers of jobs. It is creating considerable numbers of jobs. And Barclays is not the first and it's not the last to have done that. But there's tangible outputs of where the investment has been made and we're seeing results.
I'm very familiar with the Digital Boost Fund and was instrumental in delivering it as part of economic recovery. But some of the evidence we've had, particularly for female businesses, because of the nature of their business, they've had some challenges in accessing the Digital Boost Fund. So I'd be grateful if the Cabinet Secretary could agree to look further at the access to that fund for women and also for rural areas, as has been pointed out previously. But I'm happy if you can agree to that to hand back to the convener.
Very happy to agree to that. And we're very keen to be adaptable, as I said to Colin Smith. So if the committee has ideas of how to make the digital boost scheme more accessible, then I would be very keen to work with the committee on that.
Good.
Thank you. I think that is something the committee will contact you about. It is evidence to be prepared during our town centres and retail inquiry. I'll now hand over to Maggie Chapman to be followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thanks. Thanks very much, convener. And thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Good morning. And thank you for what you've said to us so far this morning. I've got a couple of questions following on from Fiona Hislop's questions. One of the things that has become very, very clear is in our town centre inquiry, the retail sector inquiry that we are coming to the end of, and thinking back over the winter, resilience, having the infrastructure in place is really, really important, but it's how we build into that infrastructure the resilience to cope with either bad weather events like Storm Arwen, or things like ensuring that as businesses and residences seek to move to sort of omni-channel or multimodal interactions, whether that's home working, whether that's bricks and clicks in retail. And I just wondered, how does the Scottish Government ensure that we can actually have not only the infrastructure, but the support that backs that infrastructure up to ensure access to reliable connections, access to resilient connections, and fast access to maintenance that will be required if there are connectivity issues?
Yeah, so it's an area where we've got to work very closely with the commercial providers at the end of the day. So working, because you talked about things like maintenance. Now, obviously, we have a real interest in supporting local broadband providers, so ensuring that it's not just some of the bigger businesses that are benefiting from this big rollout of R100. But ultimately, that means that when it comes to resilience, we need to, and maintenance and so on, we need to work quite closely with these organisations. There is a massive skills question in this too. Because when it comes to whether it's the Connecting Scotland programme, if an individual who had previously been digitally excluded and is now accessing broadband, we need to be on hand quickly and ready to respond to that need. And there's quite a number of different partners we have in that regard, including things like housing associations, to reach that. So I suppose my point is that when it comes to resilience, it needs to be localised resilience, and it needs to be at the point of need. And that includes both the providers, whether they're small, medium or large, as well as other partners that are perhaps more trusted, like housing associations, or indeed like banks. So the Barclays Eagles programme, trying to, again, equip customers, perhaps more excluded customers, with the skills that they need. I think there's a huge programme in all of that. And Ofcom have a role in this too, when it comes to resilience and ensuring that all providers are meeting a certain standard of resilience, of embedding resilience.
No, thanks for that. And I appreciate that there are challenges, as well as you identified earlier, around what's reserved and what we have powers over. But I suppose following on from that, you talk about, you know, building in connections and networks with localized to secure localized to secure resilience at local levels. I'm wondering if there are alternative models of ownership or control that we should be looking at as well. I think, you know, there's obviously a really important role for the big broadband corporations to be supporting, and mobile connectivity as well, to be supporting this. But in terms of community ownership, I think there's something potentially quite adaptable, flexible, and very localized that can secure the resilience that maybe particularly smaller towns, smaller villages and rural areas need. And I just wondered what your thoughts on that are.
Yeah, I'm extremely supportive of that, because I represent an area where there's been perhaps a disproportionately high reliance on local community solutions, whether it's Lochielnet in Lochaber, whether it's Cromarty Firth in on the Black Isle. There's lots of localised examples. And certainly the broadband voucher scheme that I mentioned earlier provided an opportunity to work with about 60 local suppliers, to again give them the opportunity to connect. And communities have been absolutely dependent on these local suppliers. So the worst thing that we could do right now is to only focus on, for example, one major provider that then unfortunately makes it harder for some of these community schemes to be commercially viable. So there is a challenge there that we need to manage quite carefully. But certainly, I think through the voucher scheme, there's an example of, it's about, as I said, 60 local broadband provider. And I could go through listing a number of the local suppliers, whether it's CloudNet and the Orkney Islands or Shetland Broadband LLP, who use the voucher schemes to connect eligible properties. So there are examples. When you start with a household, though, I think most of the time they just want a reliable connection to you. Yeah.
No, that's fair. And I think especially as we see that the continuity of sort of hybrid working post pandemic, I think that's going to be very, very important. If I can, another question around the kind of use or the application of the connectivity, whether it's broadband or mobile connectivity. And maybe this links back into something else Fiona Hislop was talking about. I think there are real opportunities, economic opportunities that maybe are emerging now. For example, in terms of one of the things I can think of is how we use 5G data to manage traffic flows to better predict supply chain issues, to better predict accidents, to better protect, you know, and the links into health, the links into food supplies, all of those things. And I'm just wondering where in the policy and strategy landscape is thinking happening around those kinds of issues.
Yeah, so definitely the thinking's happening. And if I could perhaps draw your attention to the Internet of Things, because that is part of our digital strategy. And you know, examples already of how we are using Internet of Things to, exactly as you said, who provide reliable data about the world, which then informs decision making and improves services. So, you know, at the moment, that's being used to monitor river levels for flooding. It's being used to prevent damp and social housing. And there's some superb examples, and I've had the privilege of visiting some of the social housing that's using the Internet of Things, and it's remarkable. Also examples around the health and well-being of livestock, again seeing examples with cattle, and understanding the performance of industrial machinery. So back in 2017-2018, the PFG and then the subsequent 2017 digital strategy, we committed to ensuring that Scotland had that underlying infrastructure to support widespread networks. And you know, we will continue to implement that. But I think that's a good example of where we want sort of 5G to get to as well. But it all boils down to data, how you use the data, how you have an ethical approach to the use of the data as well.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And I mean, that was going to be one of my final points as well, that data trusts and ownership of data, I think are really, really interesting questions that I'm not sure anybody has got to grips with. I think there's interesting thinking around that, but I know that's probably not so much the topic for today. I suppose my final point, and I don't know if you've got any comments on this, but if as we move to a very, very clearly digital economy where everything relies on some kind of digital connectivity, whether it is food production, livestock monitoring, traffic management, all of these things, I think there are interesting opportunities to think differently about broadband and mobile connectivity and provision and the charging. You know, there's obviously a very, very clear desire for universal provision, and I suppose I just wondered if you had any thoughts for further down the line how you see a future Scotland perhaps viewing universal provision.
So I think that we will need to be in a position of universal provision. I don't think it's optional, and I also think that it has the potential to be transformational if we get it right. So if, for example, that universal provision is a great equaliser across geographies, across income levels, across communities, and so on, then it has the potential to be transformational. I guess my concern in this regard is that we have a vision, but it ultimately is a reserved area. Telecoms is fascinating because the entirety of it is reserved. So all the powers over regulation and so on. And I think that our spend has got to go hand in hand with regulation. So if you take, for example, the banking sector, where banks close local banking hubs, and they expect their customers to increasingly rely on connectivity and broadband, then we have to put in place support for those customers, and there has to be alternative provision. But there's an example where, in some cases, the pace is moving so fast, it's leaving some people behind. And I think we need to be conscious of how we take everybody with us if we're to realise that sort of transformational objective, where broadband is another utility that you absolutely expect without question.
Thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary. I'll leave it there.
Thank you. I'll now invite Michelle Thompson to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I just want to take it back to the macroeconomic environment. Obviously, as you know, inflation was at 9.1% CPI at May 2022. We anticipate it will peak considerably higher. And of course, we've had Brexit and we've had the pandemic in terms of issues around supply chains. Indeed, as you know, our committee did an inquiry into that. I just wanted to ask, in what ways, if any, might the UK macro environment have an impact on either rising costs for delivery or the timelines for our existing programmes?
So it will inevitably have an impact on the rollout. So an obvious example, which is coming back to me through various different providers or and so on, is around labour. So at a time where there is an extreme shortage of, for example, engineers, ultimately you need boots on the ground to roll out any major infrastructure project. And if that labour market has been reduced through a hostile visa system, then you end up with providers and contractors and subcontractors all just recycling the same workers to try and deliver that rollout. The second thing is, of course, in terms of the inflationary impact on the cost of major infrastructure builds. So inevitably, again, there is an inflationary impact on some of those costs. So this major infrastructure initiative, which is huge, will not be immune to the challenges that our economy is facing. I'm going to pause and see if Robbie wants to come in on any other technical impacts. And I think he's on mute.
Hopefully that's sorted. Just on the inflationary impacts, is something that we're obviously monitoring proactively across all of our programmes. I think the nature of the contracts that we have offer some protection. So, for example, R100 essentially is kind of a fixed price contract. The only changes that can arise relate to predetermined survey assumptions. So, there are some inflationary pressures that can trigger those in some circumstances, but not across the piece, so it's not impacted by wage inflation, that kind of thing. But it is a fact of life, as we said, that the cost of raw materials, kind of component parts of the networks that have been built, those costs are increasing. I think on other contracts, like the 4G infill programme that we've talked about, our supplier WHP have secured some of these components quite far in advance, which has insulated us from some of the most recent rises in costs. I think I talked about earlier on that the construction of towers is largely complete now across the 4G infill programme. We also have some contingency that's built in with that programme to the estimated cost of towers. So there has been a kind of proactive approach to managing this as we go, which we expect the impact certainly in S4GI will be minimised. But certainly with R100, we're taking the same approach. We're working with Openreach to mitigate the impacts. And they're obviously kind of looking to innovate as they go as well and trying to push costs down. In effect, I suppose, reducing how much network build and how much of these components are needed to reach rural communities. So I think that ability to innovate and make the build more cost effective, as well as some of these contractual protections, will be a significant factor in allowing us to mitigate the risk of costs that we're on.
Well, that's heartening to hear that about what you've got built into the contracts anyway as a protection against the increase in costs. And therefore, going back to yourself, Cabinet Secretary, in terms of labour force issues, I mean, obviously the engineers in particular are real boots on the ground that have to be deployed. It's not like you can send a bot or anything like that. I mean, I know sometimes I do look at the detailed reporting of each of the programmes, and obviously they have the standard sort of function pulling out issues, but I think it would be useful for the committee to have more flavour where a gap in labour availability is pushing out timescales, because I suspect this is an issue that's going to continue to run when we look at other sectors. That would be very useful if there is more information available about that. Thank you.
Yeah, so if I were to quote, for example, the chief executive of Openreach, Clive Selley, he has described the process of recruiting workers from the EU post-Brexit and I quote, tortuous. And he stated that the Home Office points-based process is, and I quote, constraining the rate of fibre build in the UK. So Robbie set out a lot of the protections that we've put in place. But actually, you know, you only need to listen to people like Openreach, and this is featured in probably every meeting I've had with Openreach for the last a year and a half or so, is this challenge about recruitment of workers And that's over and above, you know, what some of the, let's say, local suppliers have identified in terms of struggling to source equipment due to the global supply chain issues like fibre, fixed wireless, fixed mobile hardware, and some stockists are capping the amount that can be ordered. So, you know, that's where we have stepped in and offered, for example, greater flexibility to the delivery timescales for the voucher scheme-led solutions, where the supplier can demonstrate that they're experiencing such issues. But quite clearly, they are all grappling with these macroeconomic frustrations, some of which are fixable right now, because you could fix it with, for example, visas that are specific to particular industries, or visas that are specific to particular skill sets.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, and I know that's a matter that you've raised on a number of occasions. Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I'll now bring in Gordon McDonald.
Thank you very much, Convener, and morning, Cabinet Secretary. I wanted to ask you about Project Gigabit and the UK Government's £5 billion that was set aside for the hardest to reach 20% of the population. The UK Public Accounts Committee highlighted that the UK Government Digital, Cultural, Media and Sport Department had only allocated £1.2 billion of that £5 billion. It hadn't awarded any new contracts, and it wanted to ensure that taxpayers' money was not wasted and that public funds was only used when absolutely necessary. Do you share the UK Public Accounts Committee's concerns that the UK Government's approach to rolling out Project Gigabit risks perpetuating digital inequality across the UK?
I think the way that it is being approached right now creates a massive risk in that regard. So to add to one of the to the criticisms that you've identified, there's also been criticism that the commitment has been watered down. So it's now a commitment to reach for nationwide gigabit coverage by 2030, with an aim to reach 99% of coverage. Now, we know, based on their approach and the arbitrary cost cap of £7,000 per premises, that just means that they will secure connections to the easiest to reach, most commercially valuable properties. And so inevitably, it'll be properties in my hard-to-reach constituency, Alexander Burnett's hard-to-reach constituency, and other members' rural constituency, if they just take the approach of reaching the easiest properties. And I think you're seeing that from the response from the UK government minister, where she is saying essentially that if we focus on the hardest-to-reach properties, it will be at the expense of easy-to-reach properties in England. But the whole point here is to try and reduce digital exclusion and to create a level playing field rather than exacerbate that divide. And you know, I think at the end of the day, we fundamentally need a change. It's not about necessarily additional funding. There is that £5 billion available. I don't think it's necessarily about more money. I think it's literally just about the belief that let's connect our islands, you know, let's connect the most rural peninsulas, let's get to that house which is down the beaten track that can't be connected for anything less than £7,000.
Yeah, regarding that £7,000 that you've spoken about, again, the UK Public Accounts Committee said that rural and remote areas should receive significantly increased investment on the basis that the commercial sector will be unlikely to be able to fill the gap. So, you know, if we are going to significantly increase the investment in order to cover the hardest 20%, what discussions have you had with the UK government recently about this, and is there any sign of movement on it?
It's an issue I raise with UK government ministers, whoever they are and whenever I meet them. Such is my concern about it. So whenever we end up in a visit together or whatever it is, I raise this issue, and I've raised it with the Minister for Levelling Up. I've raised it, obviously, with the Digital Minister, and I'll keep hammering it home, because for me, it's very binary. If the cost cap remains as low as it is, then the UK government is essentially excluding the properties that have most to gain from superfast broadband. And we have taken an approach with R100, which is to start with the hardest to reach and work backwards. We're willing to invest the funding, but ultimately, if we want to finish the job, then it's going to take a more flexible approach from the UK government. And I don't think it is appropriate to say that connecting an island is at the expense of connecting a town in England. It's just fundamentally different. So that would be my point. I mean, if you want to hear about the official discussions, I'm sure Robbie could come in, but that's certainly my discussions has been, no matter when an unsuspecting UK government minister and I end up at an event together, this is an issue that I raise.
Okay, thanks very much, convener.
Cabinet Secretary, would it be possible for you either today or in writing to give us an estimate of how many households are likely to be impacted by the £7,000 cap? Is that some information that you already have or are able to share with us?
Yeah, well, we'll do our level best to do that. It might be in sort of percentages rather than absolute figures, but we'll do our level best to give you as much information as possible.
That's helpful. And if I just finally ask if you've got any comments on Ofcom, is there any, when you talk about inequalities within the current funding system, is there, you know, what kind of role, I understand that Ofcom recently published their Scottish report, that was in December of last year, of where you see them as an organisation fitting into the situations that we're facing in Scotland or what they contribute.
Yeah, so Ofcom are vitally important in all of this because they obviously determine the criteria for services that are delivered. They certainly have no role in setting the parameters, though, for Project Gigabit, because their job is to obviously regulate and to establish standards. But when it comes to UK government investment and so on, they don't have a role. But I presume your question was just more about the generalities of their role rather than specifically.
Well, yes, we understand that the role of Ofcom, but whether in the discussions around Scotland getting a deal that works for us, is the information provided by Ofcom helpful in consideration? Is it something that they do take into consideration? They do have the Scotland report. Is it part of their remit to look at where the inequalities are within the UK in terms of delivery?
Insofar as they can't determine, for example, how Project Gigabit is spent or otherwise. So there's a limit there to their role, but they do have a very important role in ensuring, they certainly have an objective on that equality point, but I think there's a limit there in terms of how they determine that government funding is spent. Mm-hmm. But they do have an important role. So, for example, they determined criteria for services that were delivered under the UK government's broadband universal service obligation, and so they do have a role in that regard. But I guess it's limited when it comes to how UK government funding is spent.
Yeah, but it's certainly limited in the politics of the situation, but the information they provide can help support some of the cases that have been made today. So thank you very much for the session this morning, Cabinet Secretary. That brings us to the end of the session, and we'll now move into public discussion. So I'll close the meeting.
Thanks.